Hello and welcome to What the Hey, where I'm your regular host of What the Hey, and today on What the Hey, I'm once again reacting to yet another requested video. Today's video request comes from Mr. Saturn Gaming and Stories, so hello to you and thank you very much for requesting today's video. The video in question that I'm checking out today is titled Top 5 Retired / Inactive Steam Excursion Stars from the United States of America, which was premiered on November 26th of 2020. The video duration is 27 minutes and 21 seconds, and the video description includes hints at what will be featured in the video as well as some video creation information. The video itself was created by Andrew Raila Bammers, so hello to you and thank you very much for creating and releasing your work. Like with all of my reaction videos, if there's something in this particular video that I feel may disturb someone to some degree, I'll be sure to mention that in the video description, so feel free to check that out before watching the rest of the video. So with all of that out of the way, let's actually watch the video itself.
Number 5.
Burger King foot lettuce.
Nickel Plate Road number 587. This USRA light Mikado was originally built for the Lake Erie and Western Railroad as number 5541.
I did not know that was a railroad.
15 locomotives in her class, she was renumbered to 587 after the Lake Erie was acquired by the Nickel Plate Road in 1922. The Nickel Plate Road is where the now 587 would continue the rest of her career.
That's a very specific number.
Was used to haul freight trains across the Nickel Plate system until retirement in 1955. After being retired, 587 was donated to the city of Indianapolis and put on display in Broad Ripple Park. After being retired, 587 was donated to the city of Indianapolis and put on display in Broad Ripple Park.
That's so cool how they put them on display for people to see.
587 originally had a 16-ton tender, which was replaced with a 19-ton tender. It's also worth mentioning that the original tender had only two axle bogies, while the newer one had three axle bogies.
Bogies.
Anyway, 587 remained in the park until 1983. At the time, the city of Indianapolis was interested in building a new public library in the park, but the only available location was where the 587 was displayed.
Oh, did they remove it?
A group of people called Friends of 587 did a study and determined that the locomotive was a good project for restoration. After the arrangement, 587 was taken to the Indiana Transportation Museum where restoration began. After the locomotive's restoration was completed in 1988, she was used to haul the museum's fare train from Fishers, Indiana, to the Indiana State Fair in Indianapolis, Indiana.
So is it really retired?
In 1989, the 587 led a triple header with Norfolk and Western Class J611 and Class A number 1218 for a deadhead run to the Asheville NRHS convention. 587 led two excursions for the convention, one of them with 1218 and another with 611 for the annual Independence Limited in 1990.
That's a lot of mileage, bro.
The 587 led Nickel Plate Berkshire No. 765 on an excursion between Fort Wayne and Chicago, as well as another doubleheader with 765 as part of the NRHS convention. In 2000, the 587 was used
That's
as the star
cool.
locomotive on the children's movie Old 587, The Great Train
I've
Robbery.
I've not seen that.
Whew, I almost ran out of breath.
That is a lot of words.
Unfortunately, in early 2003, the locomotive's FRA operating permit expired. This is due to the FRA requirements that have
Fancy.
All boiler tubes and flubes from the steam locomotives to be replaced every 15
that is
years
humongous.
Or 1472 days of operation. 1472. That doesn't sound good.
No.
5 years later, the locomotive's ownership was officially transferred to the Indianapolis Parks Department of the Indiana Transport Museum. Then in 2018, a court order required the ITM to vacate its former location. The Kentucky Steam Heritage Corporation, or KISCO, made a deal with the ITM to locate the 587 and move it out of there before the deadline.
That is so complicated.
By that point, the restoration still wasn't even finished. As of the making of this video, the 587 is in storage awaiting a 1472-day overhaul at the Kentucky Steam Heritage Center in Ravenna, Kentucky. It's also worth pointing out that this is the same location where Chesapeake and Ohio Kanawha, or 284, number 2716, is undergoing a restoration, which was supposed to be completed this year, but I'm sure we all know what happened, so
I don't.
I'm not going to mention it.
Thor?
But hope
okay.
isn't lost for the 587. Once the ITM can raise enough funds for the locomotive's restoration, she will eventually return back to Indiana once the restoration is complete. It's also worth pointing out that those Nickel Plate Mikados looked very similar to the pair Marquette's Mikados.
I didn't even realize.
Okay, Very nice. Of the Paramarquette's Mercados.
That is so many numbers and so much information, and that was only number five.
Tennessee Valley.
I love Tennessee. Let's go.
The oldest locomotive on this list, this unique locomotive is one of eight S-160 locomotives
that's so specific.
Built for use on Fort Eustis Military Railroad in 1952. I hope I pronounced that
correctly.
Probably. The 610 and her sister engines were used to train soldiers in military operation and maintenance, as well as transportation on the 31-mile-long route to an interchange at the junction in Lee Hall, Virginia. After the railroad decommissioned steam operations in 1972, the 610 was acquired by the Wiregrass Heritage Center of the National Railway Historical Society in Dothan, Alabama. Hey, the very same city I was born in.
Hey, represent.
Anyway, 6 years later, the 610 was donated to the Tennessee Valley Railroad Museum in Chattanooga, Tennessee, where it was eventually restored to operation in 1991 and put into excursion service.
That looks like an old model, but...
Sadly, I couldn't find any info on when the restoration started, but oh well. The 610 lasted for 29 years in operation until 2010, but unfortunately, she hasn't run since. After the restoration of Southern Railway 630 was finished in 2011, the locomotive was moved to the TVRM's Seoul shops. Today, the 610 is awaiting
scary.
An overhaul at the Seoul shops, as it is currently undergoing a 1472-day inspection. But once the overhaul is completed, the 610 will continue her service along with 630 and Southern Railway Mikado number 4501. And on a final note, the 610 has been featured in several movies that are shown in the caption on screen. I know, I'm lazy.
Same, that's okay. I've never seen any of those.
This part was rather short.
That's okay.
Number 3. Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe number 3751. The first locomotive of its class, the 3751 was built in 1927 by Baldwin Locomotive Works.
Mm-hmm.
She originally burned coal, but was converted to burn oil in 1936.
I didn't know that was a thing.
The 3751 was then given a larger tender in 1938. In 1939, she attended the grand opening of the Los Angeles Union Station and became the very first steam locomotive to bring a passenger train to it. Then in 1941, the 3751 and her other classmates were given major upgrades, including a new frame and 80-inch diameter driving wheel.
That's impressive.
She made her last run in 1953 and was retired from service 4 years later. 1 year later, the locomotive was placed on display in San Bernardino, California.
Is that official retirement?
The San Bernardino Railroad Historical Society was formed with the intentions of restoring the 3751.
Why?
In 1986, the locomotive was moved to California Steel Industries and restoration began.
Why though?
The restoration was completed in 1991, and the 3751 moved again under her own power for the first time in 38 years. And on the 27th of December that year, literally the day after the Soviet Union fell, the 3751 pulled her very first excursion train.
Look at all that smoke.
For 37 years, the 3751 powered numerous passenger trains on the Santa Fe
I
lines
like the little
and attended
bell.
Many events, including several rail fares.
That's crazy how big those things are. Like, the perception of that is huge. Also, the quality of the images are super cool. I like this format. It's very interesting. But it's cool how all the ones that have been shown thus far kind of seem like they have older designs. It's interesting. Oh. I like the music also. I feel like I'm at like Disney or Universal right now. This is like an epic just Western music. See, that's interesting. Like you have the older design and then kind of like a newer design, I guess, maybe.
During her final years of operation, the locomotive could be seen traveling on the I-10 highway
in
Los Angeles, California. The video can speak for
itself.
That's
scary.
I mean, come on. Where else can you do that?
Nowhere, I assume. That would be so scary. I'd probably rev my car and try to race the train, but I know that'd be a bad idea. Bruh. That's cool.
Anyhow, after being displayed at the Union Station Summer Train Fest on July the 15th of 2017, the locomotive was unfortunately taken out of service again for a 3 to 4 year restoration. The restoration is expected to be completed this year, but it's likely not going to happen for a pretty similar reason for the 587 mentioned earlier. And of course, I'm not going to mention it because, well...
We don't do that here.
I know, I'm bad at it. In addition to the 3751, she also has eight surviving sister locomotives, including number 2926, which is undergoing a major restoration in working order. But the 2926 won't steal the show, so 3751 will still have a bright future of operation ahead of us.
Yay! That is so long. Bruh. Hello, children? For some reason.
Number 2. Texas and Pacific number 610.
Oh, we got the straight up country Texas music. Let's go.
I-1A Texas type locomotives of the Texas and Pacific Railroad. This 610 was built by Lima in 1927.
Whoever that is, I don't know.
A typical use of 210-4 locomotives. Spoiler alert, this 610 is also the second of three oil-burning locomotives on my list.
I didn't know they did oil.
Anyway, when dieselization on the Texas and Pacific came and went, this 610 was retired in 1951 after 24 years of service.
Oh, wow. That's impressive.
She would end up becoming two members of her class to be saved from scrap, the other being number 638. Unfortunately, the 638 only survived for a brief time before falling victim to vandalism and eventually being scrapped.
That's tough.
Anyway, after the 610 was retired, it was donated to the Fort Worth Stock Show before then being put on display at the Fort Rogers Memorial Center. In 1975, the 610 was purchased by Ross Rowland to hold the American Freedom Train for its portion of the tour in Texas. After a complete refurbishment, the 610 returned to operation and was relettered as American Freedom Train No. 610, as well as giving the appropriate paint job, too. In case you haven't heard the story, the Freedom Train was used for the intention to commemorate the bicentennial of the United States, the 200th anniversary of the United States becoming a country when it declared independence from Britain on July the 4th of 1776.
It's perfect timing, let's go.
610 remains one of three steam locomotives to ever pull the Freedom Train, the others being Reading 2101, and Southern Pacific number 4449.
I think I know that one.
After the Freedom Train tour ended, the 610 was leased to the Southern Railway in 1977 for excursion service. For this, she was given a bit of a Southern makeover and relettered as Southern 610. Unfortunately, the 610 only lasted on the Southern for 4 years before being returned to Texas in 1981 and ultimately being retired the next year. The reason for this was because the 610 didn't have a good balance between speed and power. She had plenty of enough strength to pull the Southern's increasingly heavier passenger trains, but do so at a very slow speed. For comparison, its predecessor on the Southern, Canadian Pacific number 2839,
so many
was fast enough, but too weak to pull the trains. 610's successor, Chesapeake in Ohio number 2716, had the perfect balance between speed and strength, but I'm sure we all know the story. Anyway, after being returned to Texas, the 610 was put on display on GSA property in Fort Worth, but due to GSA downsizing the property and the need to hand off the portion of the display's location to the city of Fort Worth, Texas, the 610 was moved to the Texas State Railroad in 1987. Today, the 610 is on static display at the Texas State Railroad in Palestine, Texas. To this day, she is the largest preserved non-articulated steam locomotive built by the Lima Locomotive Works, and also the only 210-4 to run an excursion service in the United States. Full restoration is unlikely, probably because of her size and her operating cost.
So I guess it's like,
with one locomotive left to go, how about I share some honorable mentions that other people have already done before me?
Yes. Goodness. This music is fantastic. I love the designs and the colors. Apparently Chesapeake in Ohio is really famous. I like the font for that, that's fun. Interesting. RIP. And very epic. Very epic. Which is it though? That I probably don't know.
The moment you've been waiting for. My number one pick remains a legend in preservation, a recently retired mammoth. Here is my number one pick on my list of retired / inactive steam excursion stars from the United States of America.
Yep. I haven't either, so I don't know. The Millennium Falcon, I don't know.
Union Pacific Heavy Challenger number 3985.
Nice. I don't know though.
You would have seen this one coming if you've paid attention to the news.
No.
The largest mixed traffic steam locomotive in the world, nicknamed Big Boy's Little Brother. This 4664 was one of 65 UP Heavy Challengers built by Alco from 1942 to 1944. 3985 was a part of the 1943 batch, which contained 25 of 65 Union Pacific Heavy Challengers. Despite being designated as mixed traffic locomotives, some of the Heavy Challengers, including the 3985, were used exclusively for freight service. 3985 served with the Union Pacific until its last run in 1957, and was soon retired from service in 1962. He ended up becoming one of two Challenger steam locomotives in the world to make it into preservation, the other being fellow classmate number 3977. After being retired, the locomotive was put into storage at the Cheyenne Roundhouse, along with Big Boy number 4023.
Big Boy. I like that.
It was brought out of storage and placed on an outdoor display beside the Cheyenne Depot.
Nice.
In 1979, a group of Union Pacific employee volunteers started a restoration on the 3985, and it was completed in April of 1981, making the mighty 4664 the largest active steam locomotive in the world. A title that it would hold for nearly 30 years. The locomotive made its first run to Rail Fair 1981. There, it attended the grand opening of the California State Railroad Museum in Sacramento.
There are so many museums.
Number 844, aka the Living Legend. Although originally a coal burner, the 3985 was prone to causing landslide grass fires, and it was eventually converted to burn fuel oil in 1990. Apart from regular excursions through the years, the 3985, along with the 844 and doubleheaders, also attended events such as Rail Fairs 91 and 1991. This mammoth has also masqueraded not one, not two, but three times. In November of 1992, the 3985 masqueraded as Clinchfield Heavy Challenger number 676, which would have been the next member if production had continued.
I like that. Santa.
Although the Clinchfield Challengers had single smokestacks instead of the twin ones on their UP counterparts, it didn't really matter in the end.
Oh.
In May of 1993, the locomotive masqueraded as its now deceased sister locomotive number 3967 for the 40th anniversary of the Rocky Mountain Railroad Club, the first Union Pacific steam excursion. During the same run, the locomotive was again renumbered to 3718 as part of a what-if masquerade. What if the locomotive had been converted to burn oil in the days of steam? This chart should tell the rest of the story.
I didn't even know oil was a thing that, like, locomotives used. I just thought it was, like, coal and diesel. I had no idea. That's a lot of numbers. I don't do numbers, personally.
Throughout the years, the 3985 was occasionally hooked up to and pulled some seriously heavy freight trains, including a 143-car train of double-stacked containers that weighed 7,600 tons. Now imagine a Big Boy's max limit.
Big Boy. Whoever made the names are great. That's recent. That's interesting. Look, oh, it's like tilting. Oh, that makes me nervous. Bruh.
The Challenger made many runs, occasionally on its old former route, until its last run in 2010. Afterward, he was taken out of service for another major overhaul. Yes, I'm referring to it as a he.
Okay, good add-in.
Unfortunately, this wasn't to be. The new R.I.P. Union Pacific Steam Team, now led by Ed Dickens, found a shocking discovery that the previous Union Pacific Steam Team had not done a complete job of refurbishing the locomotive.
Yay? What?
Numerous problems were found.
Okay.
At this point, the 3985 was seemingly undergoing a 1472-day inspection.
That's long.
But the wait went on even longer when the Union Pacific brought Big Boy 4014 to the shops for a complete rebuild in 2014, which was followed by the 844 needing another overhaul, which lasted until 2016.
Bruh.
Even after the 844's overhaul was finished, the steam team then shifted their attention to getting the 4014 refurbished in time for the 150th anniversary of the driving of the Golden Spike. But they did promise to get to work on restoring the 3985 after the celebrations and the 4014's first run. Just like the UP promised, the 4014 returned in time for the anniversary and made its first run and did everything else we all should know what happened in that incredible year of 2019.
I don't, I'm sorry.
A year that's often called the year of the big boy.
Whoever named that is great.
However, the same promise could not be said for the 3985. As time passed, even after the 4014's first excursion, the Union Pacific found more and more mechanical problems that turned into a mountain of them. Nearly 3 decades of hard running, sometimes reaching speeds of 70 miles per hour, and a few seriously heavy freight trains have ever since crippled the challenge.
I would think so.
It just goes to show that if a locomotive's first refurbishment isn't done properly, it can go very, very wrong. The 3985 was and is no longer safe to operate, and the money for a full restoration would have a cost estimate that would be more than what it cost to refurbish the 4014. Finally, the steam team and railroad felt that they could only operate and maintain 2 historic steam locomotives, 844 and 4014. Ultimately, in January of the disastrous year of 2020,
for everybody,
the 3985 was retired from service. The future for this once great locomotive is now uncertain.
Bum, bum, bum. Bum, bum, bum.
Today, the 3985 resides at one of the stalls in the Union Pacific's roundhouse in Cheyenne, Wyoming. Tenderless, as its stall's length isn't long enough for its tender to fit in. The tender is temporarily being used on Big Boy 4014. There are 2 possible futures for the locomotive.
Get scrapped.
Either being restored again when the time is right, or being donated to a railroad museum large enough for it. But for now,
The
crippled 4664 sleeps in the roundhouse as it awaits one of those 2 possible fates.
Seems a bit grim. Watching Star Wars, we got the Imperial March.
The 3985 remains a legend in preservation. The fact that it held the title of the largest active steam locomotive in the world for 29 years, masqueraded 3 different times, taught us many important lessons in preservation, and for the great memories it has brought to those who didn't live to see Big Boy 4014 run again, but lived to see this 4664 Challenger run again. It is these mega critical factors that land the 3985 the number one spot on my list of retired / inactive steam excursion stars from the United States of America.
Interesting.
My voice is dead.
I like seeing the people over there, that's fun. Hi, random dude. Hello. Person, just chilling. Don't get run over. Goodness. Chugga, chugga, choo-choo. That's so scary. It could tilt over so easily. I'm guessing not, but still. That's crazy how much footage people have of this stuff. Just all the photos and all the videos. Like, that's so cool. Like, the kind of, it's almost black and white, but not really. The music is so dramatic. I hope you had a good Thanksgiving. Oh, it is. Yeah, that is actually kind of cool that they have their own kind of photo in there. That's cool. I love doing Clue the Black Panther, that movie is so good. Very intense. Why would you include that you're not a politician? Good to point out though, I guess. Anything else? We'll see. And? Oh, okay. Obviously so much like information that I really didn't understand because I'm not that technical with locomotive stuff. Like, I know about locomotive stuff, but not like that. One of my favorite aspects of the video overall would be the graphics and the visuals that were included in it, whether that was photos or videos. Which, crediting the people at the end of that was very smart, because it was like, you could tell that there was a lot of effort put into those photos and videos, so it was kind of cool to see who did those. Personally, I don't feel like my commentary in general was that beneficial to the video overall because, as I said, I don't know about like half or really any of that. However, seeing someone give their opinions and points about different retired locomotives is kind of interesting. My only guess is that like retired locomotives are locomotives that aren't going on the rails for work. Maybe they're just riding around just to do that. But other than that, I would assume it's mainly locomotives that are in museums. Which I had no idea that there were that many museums for locomotives, that's crazy. But yeah, all of the commentary was very interesting, even though sometimes I didn't exactly understand what was being explained. And sometimes the subtitles and added words to the photos and videos was helpful. I did also think it was funny how you were kind of criticizing your own voice. Like, everyone does that when they do videos, so I totally get it. but that's essentially the reaction video. So if you have anything that you'd like for me to check out, let me know and I'll get to watching it as soon as I can. I do have a Wix website where you can see the reaction schedule that I have for the rest of the year, so feel free to check that out, but that's essentially it. So thank you very much for watching. Bye.